So yeah, what did you do during the pandemic, Steve? It looks like you've built, you know, Star Trek Enterprise of guitar rigs.
I guess, yeah, apart from doing a whole load of stuff on the house that was kind of great in a way, because obviously we typically away on tour so much that it's difficult to take on a big project because you don't have the time. And the same thing applied to this. I had, I don't know, 10, 15, 20 years worth of effects pedals that had been in boxes in the garage, the shed, and in cupboards and whatnot all around the place. They were always the one-day pedals, that one day I'm going to build this rig and I'm going to use them, you know, a home rig, like a test bed type experimental rig, not just to also have the Floyd sounds in, but so I can go kind of beyond that, you know, and make sort of more bizarre, crazy sounds for fun. So I did, finally built it, finally got the time and motivation and urge to do it.
How many pedals has it got in it?
What's God, how count? Many? There's two, three at the back, plus... There's 38 pedals in it. Oh, 39 actually. 39 pedals, and then... Yeah, I forgot about this thing, the SY-1000, which is like a multi-effects unit. So you could say there's 40, 40 in total, I guess, if all individual boxes that create noise.
What's the signal flow? So, because there's groupings of pedals, aren't there?
There are, yeah. Basically, the guitar goes into those Boss ES-8s. I've got two of those, and they kind of, one of the loops in one of them goes into a loop of the other, the input and output, so therefore you can change the order of pretty much everything. It kind of sets up a matrix, but it's all a bit confusing. You can easily get lost with it, but it means you can have, you know, a modulation, a univibe with a fuzz on it, or you can have a fuzz with a univibe on it, and many times you can have all kinds of different combinations.
For people that don't know, the Boss ES-8 is it's a pedal switcher.
It's like a MIDI controlled loop switcher. So it has eight loops in it. Six are mono, two are stereo, and you can change the order of them. You can also have a buffer on at the beginning and at the output. So the input and output can have buffers on them, which you can turn on and off, and you can save that to each individual program or patch. So if you want to use a vintage fuzz face, you can turn the buffer off. But then if you want to use something modern, you can have the buffer on, and you know, and it only comes on for that particular sound, which is really handy. Some loopers and switches, they just have a buffer and it's either on or it's off. With this, you can turn it on and off.
If you've got two ES-8s and they can take eight pedals per unit, I'm assuming, so that would mean 16 pedals, but clearly you've mentioned you've got 39 up there on the board plus...
So
how does that work?
So basically for some of the loops, they're going to a second MIDI loop switcher, which is the Morningstar switcher I'm using, and they've got five loops in them as well. So because I've got five of those, that means there's 25 pedals going through those, which then go through to five loops. So I have like, I call them like banks of compression, then so I have five compressors, then I've got five different overdrives. I've got some modulation and fuzz, and then some boosts as well, which is kind of like your power boosts, Pete Cornish boosts, the Kingsley Page, like a very mild boost. But obviously I could use them for anything, but it just gives you more scope, because the Boss units obviously are quite large, so take up a lot of space just for eight loops. So the Morningstars are quite compact, so you can get like 25 loops there.
So, what you're saying is you kind of group like pedals together, so all your fuzzies will be on one switcher and all your modulations will be on another switcher.
Yeah, it just gives me that choice of fuzz, depending on what tone I'm after, but obviously, if I want to move that fuzz before or after a chorus, it moves all five of them.
Yeah.
before or after the chorus. So it just gives you a bit more scope to move all of them. Shall I go through in order of kind of the generic flow?
You tell me, signal path.
Okay, so the compressors I have, basically the audio comes into here first. The first bank of sounds are the compression. So in this loop here, I've got this Morningstar looped into that, and then I've got these five compressors, which are the Pete Cornish OC1, which is an optical. Then there's the Origin Effects slide rig, which, as the name suggests, it's really nice on slide, but I find it's a great pedal for a lot of normal guitar tones. And the Origin Effect Cali 76, which is a classic 70s compressor. Then there's the Opto Compulator by Demeter, which again, it's an optical. I think these are both optical as well. Might be wrong there. This is an optical again. This is a Thorpe's pedal.
Yep. That's fantastic.
Yeah, nice and juicy. So they're the five compressors in that. Then that goes into the next loop there, which incorporates this. That selects that, which is for my boosts. And the five pedals I have my boosts. I've got the Color Sound Power Boost, which is the Mercari's kind of traditional one. And that's the particular model that he builds now for us. He makes different versions, but for my purposes, the other ones don't work, but this one does. So he now sells it under the name of the Aussie Power Boost, which is quite cool. Nice, quite pretty cool of him. Then there's this one here, which is a very vintage circuit made by a guy called Andy Betts, who's also a very keen Pink Floyd fan, obviously, made in Suffolk, and there's his little symbol there of the pig. But that's an 18-volt version, and that's just got a lot of headroom and masses of bass. It really is powerful on the low end there. So then we move into the Pete Cornish ST2, which again is a bit of a boost, and it's got a very open, you know, very dynamic sound, as all of his pedals do. Then we've got the Kingsley Page tube boost, which obviously has a tube in it, and that does colour the sound quite a lot, but in a really nice way. And that's, again, you use it very mild. It's one of those pedals that I use an awful lot, because it just seems to bring in so many harmonics. It just kind of adds to the sound, but it's you wouldn't use it for everything, but it's certainly a really nice pedal. So I've also got here, just because I ran out of spots there, the fifth boost slot is actually with a fuzz, and this is the Veteran fuzz, and that's a Germanium one by Adrian Thorpe pedals. And it's one of the best sounding fuzzers I've ever owned. But we did a gig out in the sun, and it basically it died for the afternoon. They don't like heat, and it just didn't work. You know, it was terrible. So, but they all do that. It's not because it's faulty. It's just the nature of a Germanium chip. So Adrian kindly built me a silicon version as well, in case we ever get in that situation again. But this one, the character and the tone of it, they're just amazing. It's a really nice pedal. This is where I switch over to this loop here. So if that one's engaged, it means all of these are now engaged at that point after the compression and boost. So the next stage is overdrive stage, which is up here. and that's that then goes down to here, which I've got. This is like a clone made by an Italian guy called Giuseppe Bagnara from Bologna in Italy. He makes all kinds of just kind of home projects, not mass market, but it's just a gorgeous pedal. Just again, it just does so much that you tend to have it on, and I use it as, again, more of a tone enhancement, of a guitar tone enhancement, rather than particularly fuzz or overdrive. Then the classic Analog Man, King of Tone, what it does do really well. Then there's the Ibanez Mostortion, which I think is a bit of a hidden gem among Ibanez overdrive pedals. Like there's the classic Tube Screamer and everything, but this one's used as a MOSFET in it, and it just has a sound about it, which I just really love, and it's got incredible sustain to it. Moving on from that, this is another Kingsley pedal with the valves in it, and this is called the Harlot, and it's kind of like a souped up version of the Tube Boost, the Page, and it just you get a lot more gain, and you know, heading into cranked valve amp territory with that one. That's those four, and the fifth one is a Cornish G2, which is his kind of germanium fuzz, and that is more of a fuzz than an overdrive. And that one I use for my lap steel guitar for things like One of These Days, and it's just it's got a gorgeous, again, fantastic tone. And I think I haven't had that one in the sun, but I believe that, or did I? Did I use that at the Pompeii? I might have taken that, but that was stable. And I know Pete does an awful lot with his transistor. He encases them in a big block of resin as well to try and protect them temperature-wise to make them a little bit more stable, which is fantastic. But if you ever need to repair it, you're in trouble because you throw it in the bin, I guess.
I thought the whole point was that they were Pete Cornish pedals were indestructible, so they never need repairing.
Well, I must say, I've had Cornish pedals for 20-odd years, and I've never, ever had a fault with one, ever. So, I mean, he told me, and, you know, he was in the Air Force in his younger years, and they used to test things by throwing it out of an aeroplane and then finding it and seeing how good they'd survived. And he did that with some of his pedals, and he said they all survived. So there you go. Okay, moving into the fuzz block. That's coming from here again. That's after the overdrive switch. So if I engage that, that engages the Morning Star, which has five fuzzers hooked up with it. And that's a like an original 70s Big Muff. So without the LED, and it's, you've got to have the right type of transistors in it. That's a really nice sounding one, and they all sound different, but that's a good one. It took me many purchases to find a good one. Then there's the P1, which Pete Cornish originally built that to try and emulate David Gilmour's Tri Big Muff that he had. They're not the same, but it's an absolutely gorgeous pedal, fantastic, and you'll hear a lot of David Gilmour's tones with that pedal. It's just got a bit of a bite and an edge to it. It's a thinner. They do the P2 as well that you use, Dave. That's got more thicker, creamier mids in it, but that's just got a bit more aggression to it, I think. Then moving on, that's the Muff Room Cloud, which is another...
It's now called the Fallout Cloud.
The Fallout Cloud.
The Muff Room Cloud, wasn't it?
But, yes, in fact, that is a Fallout Cloud, but... But I tend to put these on because with my eyes, as I'm getting older, and the height of these, I can't read what the controls are because they can be a bit tricky, but the way Adrian kind of etches them into the chrome plate there. So there's no contrast. They don't really stand out that well. But so for my purposes, I like to put labels on. Then that jumps up to the next rail above it, which there's the Civil War Sovtek Big Muff, which is a great pedal again. It's just got its own sound, very fat, very rich, but still open. And it's got a very kind of airy top end on it without ever being nasty. It's a classic pedal and very loads of character when you're playing it. You get a lot of expression out of it. And then to a classic 70s rat with the, I think it's the LM108 transistor, which is the holy grail of the transistors in the rats. And that's just got a great, really classic rock kind of 70s, 80s tone that you've heard on albums. And that's really nice after a fuzz pedal. It kind of gives you this incredible sustain and feedback on every note, and it just really wants to sing. So that's the fuzz, or obviously I've got other two other fuzzers here, so that's seven fuzzers in total, but they all sound very different. That's the thing about, they all do their own different job. Moving on to the next one, the last one here is a modulation. And
which ESA does that go into?
That's on here, that goes up there, and that's towards the end of things. That's the second to last one. So this is a mono send and a stereo return.
Okay.
So when we get into the modulations, then we start getting some stereo stuff coming back in. And that starts off with a Thorpe effects again, and that's called a deep organ, which is a chorus which he's kind of tried to emulate the classic Roland chorus, the very first vintage one, where it breaks up, you know, it's got that distortion that's involved in it. I actually thought it was a bit too distorted for me, but he kindly reduced the distortion, sent it back, and he adjusted the input stage to make it a bit cleaner for me. I've also got his camouflage, which is normally in the rig, but I'm just experimenting at the minute, and I threw one of these little electric lady ones in to do an AB with it.
Right.
And because I was trying to get the electric mistress sound for the mother solo, and for dogs, for the rhythm in dogs, chords in dogs. And I was kind of struggling. I remember when I bought that one years ago, I kind of just set it and it kind of did it straight away. And I thought, I'll get the sound with this and then I'll use that to search for the sound. Because there's so many knobs on the Thorpe, it's easy to get lost. Yeah. Do you know what I mean? So it's, and where that's just got the one knob and a switch, but where it's got another little trim at the top.
That's
there.
The Moore one.
Yeah, the Moore one, which is for the money, I think they're absolutely stunning little pedal. But I have got an original early 18-volt electric mistress in my spares, and I'm really tempted just to get that, put that in this, and I'll put the Moore as the spares in for the touring rig, because they're just such a great pedal, they really are. And the other ones are so, they're old now, they're probably a lot more fragile, so it would be a lot healthier to be sat here in a studio. So then the next thing I've got there is it's called the pinwheel, and that's like a tremolo, like a Leslie sim, I guess. That one goes into stereo, and that one's it's got this lovely dynamic type thing, so the heavier you play, the faster the Leslie will spin, and obviously if you back off and play really gently, you can get to that slow Leslie speed as well, which is really nice and useful. Then the next one is it's called a treverb, which is obviously a tremolo and a reverb, and I'm mainly using that just as a reverb. I do like the tremolo that's in it as well, but that's stereo, so it's a very nice stereo effect, and they remind me of the Strymon effects, but like the Big Sky, it's kind of got that kind of it's a bit processed sounding, but it's like a very nice clean vibe. Okay, so that's kind of explains the Morningstar pedals, what's going through all of those. If we come in for this input here, so obviously it comes into the different Morningstar, and then this switcher here, so we've come across here, I've got a it's a 60s uni vibe. And that's this unit up here, which is based on the original, obviously classic Univibe pedal from the 60s, and it's an optical one again. That goes into the CC1, which is this pedal here. Again, it's kind of like I'm using it as a fuzz pedal. It's another drive pedal that Pete Cornish makes, but it's just got a beautiful EQ stage on it. It's got bass, mid, and treble on it, so you can really kind of contour it. I think that's the pedal I'm using for the lap steel in one of these days.
Oh, okay.
But I think I might cascade these two. But this is just, you know, massive with the bass and mids pushed on a slide. You just get all that grunt and warmth coming through. It's a really good pedal. Very, you know, tidy as well for the amount of gain you get, very clean. So then I'm going into obviously the block of fuzzers. Then I've got two tube drivers next in that, and basically they're set slightly differently. One's more cleanish, just to fatten the sound, and the other one's got more gain and poke. They're very big and dynamic and open again, but they just have their own sound. David Gilmour, especially in the is recently, well, say recently, but his solo stuff, you know, which when you see his live pedal boards that he uses, he usually has two, sometimes three of those.
I think on his Pulse board he had a couple of them as well, didn't he? When it was the yes. Division Belt 2 in 94.
Yeah, they were the Chandler tube drivers right. as well, which is made by, apparently BK Butler was the guy that worked at Chandler's, and he's now kind of taken his design, and because he designed it. Yeah, and he's, I don't know if he had a deal with Chandler or whether they just don't exist anymore. But finally, we've got another Univibe, which is a third one, which is actually a pretty weird one, but it's in a Zoom multi-effects little stomp pedal, but it's called the Vibe, and I just really like the sound of it. And what I like about it is you can obviously change all the settings, and it's got quite a lot of different settings that you can alter and then store it, and then you can store, I think you can store about 30 or 40 sounds in it or whatever. So you can have all these different versions of it stored in there, and it's great for instant recall when you want it. Whereas obviously the other ones, you can move a knob and knock it, and you kind of, you've lost that sound, and then you come back one day and you think, what was it? And well, at least they're all stored in that one. Okay, so then that comes back into this unit at this point, and then it goes into this Free the Tone programmable graphic equalizer. And that's a really nice graphic, actually, and it's the sound quality of it is very transparent and dynamic, you can change the frequency ranges. You get a choice of three different sets of frequencies you can change, and it's global. Once you've set it, that's it. You can't have a patch on one, you know, EQ range and another, so you're stuck with it. So I've got another graphic which is later on, and I've kind of staggered them to give me as many frequencies as possible that I can adjust. But yeah, mono, and this is obviously before some of these other pedals. And that then goes up to it's called a Mel, and it's kind of like a Mellotron pedal by Electric Mistress. And it takes your normal mono guitar signal, and then it can layer it or replace it with the sound of several instruments, and they make, well, you know, you've had the Hammond one, haven't you?
I've got the
and there's the synth one, the synth 9 or whatever it's called, which is the one I use for some synth sounds in the show. And then this is a Mellotron, but there's a particular sound on it which is, I think it's a flute. I think it's a flute, and it just, the way it behaves, it kind of works. It works in different octaves, and I just find if I layer it really subtly, it kind of makes you sound like you've got a double track guitar, and it fattens the sound of the guitar.
Cool.
And it's just a really nice pedal to more for original stuff, but it just gives you an extra flavour. But without any MIDI type of tracking stuff, it's quite clever the way they've done it. And then that goes into, from the Mel, then I've got a noise gate, which you can't see, which is at the back, but it's the best noise gate I've ever used. And it has two inputs, and it has one input for the signal chain and a second input for your guitar. So right at the very beginning, when it comes into here, there's a tuner output in this, and that gets sent off to the
so side chain.
It's a side chain, yeah. So you
side chain,
so
mate.
And it's because I can have all seven fuzzes on, and it works as beautifully as a noise gate. Whereas it's just in, you know, yourself. Once you start cascading pedals, there's that much gain and noise, no gate's ever going to stay shut. where this just, it's remarkable.
So this is reacting to your clean guitar signal.
Yes.
But actually doing the signal processing on the post fuzz.
Yeah.
That's cool.
Yeah, it is really cool. And then I can also insert a volume pedal before that if I want to as well. But to be honest, I just have the guitar triggering it, and that just seems to work dynamically. It just seems to do a really good job of it. And I'm trying to think, it's got some weird, crazy name. I think it starts with Z, but I just can't recall what it says. It's been buried behind there for 3 years, so I haven't seen it. It was a set and forget job, so it's, anyway. The next one, that's where this is a stereo loop, and it's sending out a signal to this Boss SY-1000. Which is like a multi-effects unit, and also incorporates the GK pickup stuff on it, so you can have different tunings or synth instruments, or, you know, banjo, sitar, 12-string, whatever you want, and different tunings, obviously, like a Dagdad or a Drop D, or transpose the whole lot.
So you can choose to use that or not use that, switch that in if you want
a, yes,
or keep it really analog and old, yep, school if you don't.
Yeah, it's purely... You know, it's purely in that loop. So, because these Boss, it has a buffer in it, obviously. So, it's certainly, there's no true bypass with any of these Boss equipment. And the buffers do change the sound of the guitar. There's something about a Boss buffer which, for certain sounds, they're great. For other sounds, I think they take away some magic, you know, from the guitar. So, it's really important to be able to pull it out the chain with everything, really, so you have the cleanest signal path. But it's a phenomenal unit, that. It's literally got three guitar rigs in it. You've got two analog ones, and then you've got the GK pickup one, which you can set to infinite different combinations of sounds and amplifiers, speakers and effects and all kinds of stuff. So that's like the Swiss Army knife. If I can't get stuff out of here, I can pull that one in, and that can kind of fill in the holes. Then after that one, we've got this last pedal there, which I'm trying to think, is it even used? I might even have a spare one. I think that might come out and go to this unit down here, which is called... it's called a psychedelic amplifier machine, which is a 60s unit, and it's just the fuzz from hell. And I think sometimes I patch that into it. But the signal path would then, it comes out of the stereo signal path of this, and then it goes into, I think it goes into this. So it goes into this here next, which is the EQ 200, which is a stereographic equalizer.
Right.
Again, with all the MIDI presets, so you can have a different curve on every patch. And that then sends that into this Free the Tone Future Factory, which is a stereo programmable delay unit, very capable. And again, they have just this great sound about them, the Free the Tone pedals. They're just very transparent and clean. You know, they don't really add any noise, you know, compared to a lot of stuff. And then finally, something I really, really love is this Strymon Volante, which is basically a, you know, Benson Ecorec in a box. And again, you've got all the MIDI presets. So if you have 150 sounds or whatever, you can have a different delay setting, and I do have a Benson Ecorec, which is a great piece of kit, but I just find the versatility with this. It also has a spring reverb built in, which for those, if you just want a really vintage bluesy guitar sound, that vintage spring reverb, and it's a really good spring reverb
that they've built in it.
You can't, it doesn't do the Star Wars laser trick.